We have planned a very instructive stream today, instructive session ahead of us. But first of all, let me introduce you to Swapnil. So Swapnil is a grandmaster, first of all, a very strong and talented player. He is a trainer, he is an author, and he has been coach of Indian team as well. And we are so hyped to have you here.
I am a grandmaster, but mainly I'm into chess coaching for quite a while. Mm-hmm. And I have trained one of my students, in fact, one of my first students, Raunak Sadwani. He became a grandmaster very early, mm-hmm. around 13 years and 9 months or something.
Wow, that's amazing.
So he was one of the youngest grandmasters in the world. Yeah, and yes. You know, whenever your first student achieves such a feat, it gives you a lot of motivation to keep coaching the professional players.
Yes,
so yeah, I'm into professional coaching for quite some time, and I have also, since you know this lockdown, there were no students coming to my home and so on, so I thought, why not to explore this area of being a chess author. So I thought let's write some books and let's do some chessable courses. So yeah, I have been active over there as well. Like, I have written articles and opening databases for Modern Chess, which is a famous opening website. Mm-hmm. Plus, I have also written a course on Benko Gambit for Chessable website.
Yes.
And I'm also, as the topic of today's session is Mastering Weak Pawns, which is mm-hmm. my upcoming course for Chessable. It's called Micro Plans, Mastering Weak Pawns. So basically, micro plans in the sense that the moves, the solutions to all the problems are kind of very small, like mm-hmm. opponent cannot do anything against him to prevent them. Mm-hmm. So they are small, they are mini, they are micro in that sense. And Mastering Weak Pawns is basically the entire topic of the course, where we, first of all, so basically this course and also this session that we are going to have today is mm-hmm. divided into four segments. Okay. The first one is where we take a look at different weak pawns in chess. This helps us recognize the weak pawns with clarity in any given position. Okay, so that's very important according to me. The second segment will be looking at different methods by mm-hmm. which we can create weaknesses in our opponent's pawn structure.
Okay, this is going to be very useful, isn't it? For all the levels.
The third segment is going to be where we explore methods on how to hit those weaknesses. So what happens next? Like, if we create a weakness in opponent's pawn structure, what we are going to do next with it, right? And in the fourth and the last segment, we have to recognize weaknesses in our own pawn structure, and we have to explore methods of improving our own pawn structure, our own weaknesses.
Okay, so it is like, first we are going to learn about the theory and then how to use it in practice by maybe going through some of the games and how it can be useful in our own games. So
exactly,
that is perfect. Going to be our topic for discussion today. Are double pawns a weakness or not?
Yeah, basically it depends, it depends completely on the position of the pieces and other specific stuff. Mm-hmm. But in general, there are some advantages and disadvantages, not just about the double pawns, but about all the pawn weaknesses. So
yes.
Let's say, even if you take isolated pawn, it is a weak pawn in itself, but it provides mm-hmm. other dynamic advantages to a player.
Yes, take note, guys, because especially those who are new to chess, they always, think that double pawns is a weakness and something to be completely avoided. But it is not always the case, and as he told just now, it can also help you in activity of pieces. It can give you an open file.
So this is the first type of pawn structure that I wanted to talk about, which is double pawns cluster. Now, the drawback behind this pawn cluster is that, let's say, if you want to gain space on the king side, white can do it pretty quickly with f4, g4, h4, right? Just push the pawn straight away. Mm-hmm. But black, on the other hand, cannot do the same, because he has to, let's say if he moves the pawn to f5, then he has to move f6, then again this pawn, the pawn which is behind the f6 pawn, has to wait for its turn to move forward because the pawn is sitting in front of it. Mm-hmm. So the mobility is a huge issue in double pawns cluster, because they cannot move forward very efficiently. That is one issue. Another issue that I want to point out is the position of the adjacent pawn is very important. So in this case, the pawn is on g7, which is fine. Mm-hmm. But if the pawn moves to g6, we can see that both the pawns on f6 and f7 are not protected by any other pawns, right? So let's say if black plays g6 in this position and white puts his pawn on e4, preventing black from playing f5 on the next move, then mm-hmm. this pawn on f6 can become a target for white's pieces.
Okay, yes, it looks pretty bad after e4, right?
Perfect. And also, we can consider a case where black plays the pawn all the way to g5.
Mm-hmm.
Then not only these two pawns are weak, but if white plays e4, the square on f5 also becomes a huge weakness.
Mm-hmm.
And if white manages to establish a piece over there, preferably a knight, then the entire kingside starts to crumble for black. The most ideal way to place a double pawns cluster is to place the pawns in such a way that only one pawn among this cluster is unsupported. So right now, let's say this is an original pawn cluster which we voluntarily accept out of the opening. Now we should try to place the pawns, for example, the pawn on f5 and the other pawn on g6.
Okay.
So in
so
this
that
case,
is the
pawn on f7
defends
g6. Yeah, that's the best setup to place the double pawns cluster, because this pawn on f7 will defend the g6 pawn. And the g6 pawn in turn defends the f5 pawn. So only one pawn, that is the base pawn, f7 pawn, remains unsupported.
Okay.
So that is the only target that white pieces can aim for.
Mm-hmm. So we are already on chapter 1 and we learned something new.
Yeah.
Okay.
So let's move on to the next weak pawn now. Next type of weak pawns, which is the isolated pawn here.
Oh,
right?
this is a very common. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
So basically, what I wanted to mention in this case is that the pawn on d5 in itself is weak, but it gives other dynamic advantages to black. For example, it gives freedom of development for the pieces, more activity for your pieces.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, as we approach the end game, the pawn on d5 starts to feel the heat. It becomes vulnerable.
Okay, so... So we have an isolated pawn here. So maybe we can say it is preferable in the middle games, but in end games, it can become a target.
Right. So this is the second type of weak pawns, right? Now let's move on to the third one. Right, so these are double isolated pawns, which is, they are isolated. So it's a type of isolated pawns, but they are also doubled. So it's kind of a mixture of the previous two type of weak pawns that we saw. So a backward pawn is a pawn which is basically left behind compared to the other pawns, which are on the adjacent file. So for example, the adjacent pawn, so basically the c6 pawn is a backward pawn in this case, because the adjacent pawn, the d5 pawn, has moved forward and the c6 pawn is a bit behind, right?
Mm-hmm.
And apart from that, it usually stands on the semi-open file.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the characteristics of a backward pawn. And also the square in front of the backward pawn is usually covered by opponent's pawn, making it really difficult for the backward pawn to push forward.
Mm-hmm. So so in chat, a lot of them were saying f2. So why shouldn't we say f2 is a backward pawn when it's behind?
f2, g2, h2, we can all say these are backward pawns. But first of all, they are on their original square. So usually pawns on the original square, very rarely they become backward. But let's say if I move their colleagues forward, let's say g3 and h4, then we might say that f2 pawn is a backward pawn because there's no one standing near him, near it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So backward pawns are usually very much afraid of opponent's rooks. So if we can always, imagine that if white manages to double his rooks on the C file on C2 and C1,
mm-hmm.
then the C6 pawn comes under huge pressure because it cannot be protected by any other pawn. And mm-hmm. black spaces will have to defend it.
Okay, so all the time. Whenever there is a backward pawn, it's a good policy, like in this case for white, to try to stop that pawn going forward and exchanging itself.
Correct. So it remains stuck over there, and we can slowly create pressure on the backward pawn, and mm-hmm. we can start hitting it. Okay, so let's go to the next type of weak pawns. Now, the next type of weak pawns that I've mentioned are fixed pawns. I have not seen any chess book which basically has talked a lot about fixed pawns.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, fixed pawns are the pawns which are completely immobile because there is a pawn standing right in front of it, opponent's mm-hmm. pawn standing right in front of it. So in this case, we can see that the pawn on a5 and b6 and the pawn on a6 and b7 are fixed because they are standing in front of each other.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whenever there are fixed pawns on the board, which happens in almost all the openings, whenever there are fixed pawns on the board, the base of that pawn chain is always weak. So in this case, mm-hmm. this is a very small pawn chain, but the base here for white is the a5 pawn.
Okay,
black manages to place his pieces and attack the a5 pawn comfortably, then white comes under pressure. Now let's go to the final type of weak pawns. It is not exactly weak because people often voluntarily go for this type of pawn weaknesses, which is called as the pawn islands. Mm-hmm. So basically pawn islands are like a normal island. Basically we have more pawn islands than our opponents. So that mm-hmm. is some sort of a weakness, because it takes more energy to defend a number of pawn islands in our position. Rather if you compare it to intact pawn structures.
Okay.
So in this case, if you want to explain this with an example, we can see that white has three pawn islands. So one is on a2, b2. The other is on d3, e2, and mm-hmm. the third one is on g3 and h2. So white has three pawn islands, while mm-hmm. black, on the other hand, has only
two pawn islands.
Yes. One on king side and the other on the queen side.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is it. These are the general type of pawn weaknesses. There are other pawn weaknesses as well, but they don't occur so frequently in games. So I have decided to focus on these weak pawns.
Okay, it's like, you know, Chadwilas. Sorry, like we have talked about most important ones, but maybe Chad will say, okay, there are triple pawns, four pawns, but it is similar to what we are talking about.
Yeah, basically it will fall into any one of these categories. Mm-hmm. And these are the most frequent, and it occurs from a lot of openings.
Mm-hmm.
To summarize all the weak pawns, I guess there's a position in front of you mm-hmm. where you can see all the types of weak pawns that we saw till now in action.
Okay, yes.
Now it's time to dive into the second segment of this session, which is basically, the name that I have given to this segment is Become a Spoiler.
Okay.
So basically you have to spoil opponent's pawn structure. So basically, you know, when you want to spoil opponent's pawn structure, there are three general methods to achieve that. The mm-hmm. first one is we can use exchanges. We can force undesirable exchanges on our opponent, and we can spoil his pawn structure.
Mm-hmm.
The second type of method which players use frequently is pawn breaks. So, and the third frequent type of method by which we can weaken opponent's pawns is by fixing the pawns on very vulnerable squares.
Okay.
So what we'll do first is we'll take a look at examples of all the three methods.
Okay.
So in this game, we will see how Karyakin uses the power of exchanges to weaken opponent's pawn structure, right?
Yeah. So how Karyakin is a spoiler in this game.
Yeah, exactly. And how we can be one as well.
So okay.
e4 c6, d4 d5. Black has two pawn islands here, but mm-hmm. white, on the other hand, because of this pawn exchange, has three pawn islands. And that's a bad news. It's not immediately, you know, it's not something like you gain a huge advantage immediately, but it becomes a concern for a long time to come.
Okay,
so
sure.
Because of the lesser pawn islands and white has more pawn islands, black has better pawn structure.
All the pawns are on light squares, and since white has the dark square bishop, he can't really target any of black's pieces or pawns.
Right. And because of this pawn weaknesses, white's pieces are so passive that white is completely busted after knight c5. So after knight c5, white took here, black took here. And after that, black is just winning, because the rook will come back when the pawn on c5, and the pawn's weaknesses remain intact as they were from the start.
Yes.
So yeah, this was an easy game for black now from here on. So this was a game by So Wesley. We will dive straight. We'll look at a position straight from the move number 9.
Okay.
It is a Sicilian opening game. So here Wesley So found a very ingenious way to weaken opponent's pawn structure starting from this move onwards. So first of all, So Wesley exchanged the knight on c6, knight into c6. Now it's clear that if black takes bishop into c6, white has a very strong idea.
Yes.
So yeah, knight d5 is the correct move, exploiting the fact that the rook is sitting directly in front of the black king. And now the move that So Wesley played in the game, when I was watching this game live, I was clearly surprised by the move that So Wesley played here. He played knight a4, which mm-hmm. completely bemused me. Like, why is he taking his knight on the edge of the board? But then I figured out, then I saw the game and I knew that he had a very interesting idea, a very interesting pawn break in mind that would weaken opponent's pawn structure. So here black plays bishop e7 with a clear idea of going for short castle. Yeah,
yes.
White played c4, he castled, and here white played c5, which is perfect.
Okay, very interesting.
So c5 is a good move, because basically it forces black to take on c5, mm-hmm. or white is going to take on d6 followed by e5, which creates a fork here, right?
Okay, so what about d5 here?
Yeah, d5 makes a lot of sense. So d5 would have prevented black from ruining the pawn structure, but at the same time it gives white amazing space advantage. So that's the reason why black decided to grab the pawn on c5, and after bishop e3 attacking the pawn on c5, there's no other no comfortable way to defend it. So black goes c4, and now white wins the pawn back with knight b6 followed by knight into c4. And okay, we can see that starting this operation starting with the move knight a4, c4, c5, and then recovering the c pawn, white has managed to create more pawn islands in black's position. And yes, especially the pawns on c6 and a6 are isolated pawns, correct?
Yeah, exactly.
So this is a beautiful pawn break example when white played c4, c5, used the pawn break to create.
White sacrificed the pawn, but in this case, it was like a positional sacrifice because it was easy to regain back the pawn.
Easy to regain back, and the resulting position is clearly in white's favor because of the isolated pawns on black's queen side. Right. So let's move on to our third example, which is a technique called fixing pawns. Basically fixing our opponent's pawns on the most vulnerable squares where they can be easily attacked and they can become a target for our pieces. Right. So c4, basically offering a exchange of pawns, and if bc4, which is a very natural move, black develops this bishop with bishop c4, and it's again a complete equal game. There are going to be more exchanges and the game might end in a draw. But from here on, as I mentioned earlier, Andreyev uses a method of fixing pawns. So first he fixed the pawns on the queen side with b4. After b4, bishop d3, rook a8, bishop g6. Nihal is offering exchanges, offering more and more exchanges. Takes, rook d8. He exchanged rooks as well.
Oh yes,
and again,
I remember this endgame now. I remember. And this is very instructive bishop endgame. This
endgame
is very beautiful. Very beautiful. Okay.
So g4. A4, advancing the pawn further. Bishop e4, of course black is not going to exchange at this point. Bishop d7, bishop d3, and here black fixed the pawns on a2. So basically this pawn, as we mentioned in the introduction of fixed pawns, the base pawn is very vulnerable. Here white's pawn on a2 is quite vulnerable. If black by any chance manages to get his bishop on b1, then the pawn on a2 falls, and with it, the entire pawn chain just disappears from the board.
Yeah.
Right. So here, suppose, so basically white played the bishop b1. Our strategy is clearly to figure out a way to hit the weak pawn on a2. We cannot do it with the bishop. So we have to somehow manage and bring our king and sprint it towards the pawn on a2. So f4 is the correct move because we want to get an entry for our king all the way to b2. So that we can attack the b1 bishop, force it to move away from the b1 square, and then we win the pawn on a2.
Yeah, this is quite a surprising move, isn't it? It feels like it was a much comfortable draw, but suddenly one move can change the complete nature of the position here.
Exactly. So, it all seems so drawish till the end.
Yes.
But suddenly one move, one pawn sacrifice, our king gets the entry, and then it's just over. So white played king f4, and after king d4, this king just sprints towards the pawn on a2. White tried to play for a few more moves, but it was just too early.
Yeah, e5
so,
is nice.
Yeah,
so
he had time.
Not even letting
yeah,
white
the
important counter chances.
Right. So first we have to take care of opponent's counterplay, and then we can continue with our plans. And this is another nice move because maybe black would have just gone here and won the game as well. But this clearly eliminates all the counterplay, and we have all the time in the world to get back to b2.
Yeah, well done. Guys, let's thank Swapnil for joining with us today. And we really enjoyed this session. Hope you can join us again and we can continue our discussion on the pawn structures. And we really learned a lot today. So thank you for being here. And we wish you all the best for your channel, for your streams, and your streaming career ahead.
Thank you.